turning it off and on again. I apparently didn't turn it off and on again the right number of times. No, I want to be on the screen. Where's my screen gone? I'm full screen on the wrong screen. This is terrible. Hello. So, I, Paul Evans, you might know, my talk, yes, is 1 in 1,000,000. Kind of subtitled, How to Accurately Measure Things and Why the World Hates You. So, I'm going to be doing two Pearl Talks at London Pearl Workshop. I'm going, well, there's going to be a whole load of other Pearl Talks here. So I thought I would do something that isn't quite Pearl. And it is, in fact, about some hardware, which I actually remembered to bring. So, what I'm going to talk about is precision measurement and what precision really means, specifically what it means in electronics, which is the subject. And how the real world is going to get in your way, because it does, and how you can limit this. So, my talk is about this precision voltmeter that I've made. There's a long and slightly boring story about how I came to make it, so we'll kind of skip that bit. But it kind of looks like this when it's all. I haven't got the power supply here, so I can't really power it up and show you. But when it's running, I brought it to you, see how big it is, not really. When it's running, there are quite a lot of digits on the screen. And it's got some little fancy bits and pieces inside, which I'll talk about a bit later. But the overall goal is to have a very precise display of numbers here. So we've got 5 digits below the decimal point, and this is it, kind of sitting in situ in my workshop. It's actually a little bit of noise, because there's nothing actually plugged in, and it's still showing 10, but never mind. So the idea of precision measurement is primarily about how many digits do we have? How many significant figures have we made our measurement? But simply having precision is not necessarily sufficient if it's not accurate. Because we may have 17 digits, but if we can only cross the first 4, it's kind of useless. And now, the other way around, people often kind of conflate these two. But it's possible to have something that's very accurate without it being very precise. If you imagine somebody standing in Parliament Square, facing away from the Houses of Parliament, he's got no idea what the time is. But as soon as that, well, actually the bell isn't going to ring at the moment because they're cleaning it, but as soon as that bell were to ring, he would know it is spot on the hour. If the bell isn't currently ringing, he doesn't know what the time is. So he hasn't got much precision. He doesn't know exactly how many minutes past the hour it is, but the moment it is dead on the hour, he knows, bang, it's dead on the hour. So these two aren't necessarily related, and you kind of have one without the other, but it's best to have them both together. Another thing that's also useful in measurement is a concept called repeatability. And you know, you measure something, you might find it's like 5.35. You want to know if you take the same instrument, you try to take the same measurement, the same object, are you still going to get the same number? And repeatability is again one of these things that even if you don't necessarily have the accuracy, because maybe somebody else's instrument might measure a different number, but if I always get the same number out of my instrument, that is already kind of useful, because I can use my instrument to compare multiple different objects, and I can come up with my own numbers. They may disagree with somebody else's numbers, but if they're repeatable, that's already kind of useful. So all of this discussion of accuracy and precision and so on kind of concerns itself with the concept of error. And really what we want to do with precision instruments is have an upper bound on what we expect the error to be. So we're measuring some kind of object. It's going to have a true value of whatever quantity we're trying to measure. But what we want to know is how much is our measurement of it going to differ from reality. And it's nice if we can have an upper bound on that. Because if we know what the upper bound is, then we know, well, the true value is going to be somewhere in here. Is this good enough for our purposes? Instruments will often give each idea of an error as a percentage, but for really precision instruments, you're working with these things here, the ppm, parts per million. And usually with proper precision with a capital P measurement, you're trying to aim at one part per million. Talk. So this is about how do we measure things to one part per million. Now one, I only wrote these slides yesterday, I've already forgot the order of them, never mind. So what things are going to get in our way? There are lots of random noise type errors that are just going to get in the way. And there's not much we can do about this. But there are also other kinds of errors that are going to kind of be repeatable. So your equipment may, you may just know, oh yeah, that always measures, you know, three above whatever the true reading is, whatever. You can kind of cope with that. If you've got something like a weight measuring or a length measurement or something, you always have the idea of a reference. So kind of everything you measure is measurement based on a reference value that ultimately goes up to sort of national standards bodies and things. So like the national standard body have their idea of how long a meter is. Well, if your equipment was calibrated wrong to the idea of a meter, then kind of all your numbers are wrong. But as long as you know what that is, you can kind of work with that predictive model. And you can have other things. So yeah, what I was going to say is one part per million. So as an example of what one part per million really means, if we're going to say measure a distance, we decide that an average height of a person is about 1.8 meters. One part per million is 1.8 micrometers. Now, to give an idea of how small that is, he's about a aluminium foil, 16 micrometers thick. So that means if someone is standing on a piece of aluminium foil, we can't even measure their height to 10 parts per million. So the idea of measuring someone's height to one part per million is suddenly sounding like a really hard problem. Let's try a bigger distance. London to Edinburgh, 500 kilometers. So one part per million of that is 500 millimeters. Well, this table in front of me looks about, actually that looks even bigger than that. So if I'm gonna measure the distance to Edinburgh, I make a one part per million error if I kind of stand on the other end of this table. It's getting quite a small difference. Let's try mass instead. Measure the mass of a person, let's say 70 kilograms, according to Wikipedia. Yeah. One part. It depends on the person. So one part per million of that is going to be 70 milligrams. So that means if a bee lands on you while you're measuring your weight already, you're more than one part per million off. That sounds pretty good. And finally, this one I think is most useful. If you are measuring time, let's say we're trying to put an event somewhere inside a year. A year is 3.15 million seconds long. No, 31 million seconds. That means one part per million is 30 seconds. So for example, if we're trying to pinpoint somebody's birthday within the year, by the time we sung them happy birthday twice, we're kind of already past that one part per million error. That's really terrible. Now one part per million in electronics. If you're measuring, say, a voltage, you might have an input that's about 5 volts. So one part per million, that's 5 microns. I don't have any good examples, any kind of real-world examples of how hard 5 microvolts is, but it's tough, and I'll explain some of the reasons why. How am I doing for time? Okay, I'll speed up a bit. Okay, so this is a kind of a simple little block diagram of what's in my revolving today. So, kind of the primary core is this little bit here called the anode digital conductor. What that does basically is put a voltage into it, and it spits out a number. And the only reason it knows what that number is that it's trying to make it's measuring how much of a reference value as compared to the input value. So it can't give you an absolute number in volts. All it can say is, well, it's a certain fraction of my reference. So you need this very accurate reference in there as well to know to be able to compare it. And then your other problem is that, for example, this voltmeter is powered at 5 volts. Well, that means you can't put more than a 5 volt signal into it. So if you want to measure things that are higher than that, you kind of need to divide them down. So you have a little bit of divide by changing the current. Kind of divides the input voltage down, say 10 to 1, in this case, 10 to 1. And it needs this little current buffer, basically, it's the amplifier just to make sure that the ADC connection goes. So there's a number of components, I'm trying to say. And they all have an effect. Because, as I said, the kind of the king of things that will get in your way is this ever-present noise. Where does noise come from? Basically everywhere. And the only things really you can do about that noise is to buy better components. You pay more, you tend to get lower noise things. Sometimes you can do things a little bit fancier. For example, you can get some better materials. I happen to have the cheap connectors on the front here, but if you pay a lot more money, you can get connectors, special connectors that are plated with different metals that kind of have lower thermal noise, and you can play lots of little games by just ever more money you pay, you can start getting rid of the noise. So eventually the noise is no longer the main problem. Another main problem that we get are offsets, where just because we're putting in, say, exactly 5 volts into here, maybe this buffer chip has a little internal offset, and that by really becomes 5.01 or 05 or something like that. And these offsets are often very small for most cases. Like if you're making like an audio amplifier or something, you kind of don't care about that. But if you're trying to aim at this one part per million, that's a problem. Similarly on the ADC, there'll be an offset. How do you solve that? Well, you can get better components. But the main thing you want to try and do with that is to calibrate them out. Because a lot of these offsets are fairly, you buy a chip and it may have, say, 3 millivolts of offset, but it's always going to be 3 millivolts. You wouldn't know it until you bought that particular chip, but that particular chip is only 3 millivolts. So you can start to measure it and you can say, well, I can just subtract that from my reading, as long as it's stable. So you start to have the idea that your circuit can have lots of error sources in it, but as long as they're stable, you can account for them. And I'll just start quickly skipping through. Your divide by 10 might be exactly divide by 10, your reference might be exactly 5 volts or whatever it is. But again, as long as they're stable, you can calibrate them out. And that's all good. So to kind of summarize how you get all of this precision, you've got a whole bunch of random inaccuracies, nothing much you can do other than pay more money to try and get better components that have no noise to them. And as years go on and manufacturers get better at making things, you kind of get better and better new components that are often kind of a whole effect of the ones of a decade ago or so. Circuit construction techniques, you can start putting metal shielding pans around things to stop literal electromagnetic noise getting in there. That whole thing's in the metal phase anyway. And then you try to identify what your predictable inaccuracies. You can model them, you can calibrate them out. A lot of them become temperature dependent. And this is now my last slide, so I'll just get on to this is a calibration certificate that I got with that little voltmeter, where they basically measured it, and they measure the temperature. It turns out this is very important, because a lot of the inaccuracies and the offsets and things will vary on temperature. So suddenly you have to start playing games where you keep the thing at a constant temperature, possibly up to and including putting it in an oven that keeps it at a certain temperature to try and measure it and try and get these temperatures to whatever it was calibrated to, and then you get an agreement with all your digits. And that's kind of it. Thank you.
Any questions?